14 regarding the gift of the Spirit to God's church at Pentecost, and likewise, of course, down here at the end of time. We come to camp this year, I hope, expecting that the lab rain isn't too far away.
Amen.
We hope to cover this very camping. The tearing time has gone on for too long, and it's certainly a time there for God to work amongst his people. And in doubt of the power needed to finish the work and bring about the second coming of our Savior Jesus Christ. Now, during the year, my mind has been exercised in regard to certain conditions which must be met to bring about this great blessing. And we have to learn much more yet about the true science of prayer, which has been in our consideration in the past as well. When we come to Pentecost, we go back to Pentecost, we find that as those men prayed to receive the blessing that came, and Sister Wright says on page 38, now heaven rejoiced in being able to pour out upon the church the riches of the Spirit's grace. Heaven rejoiced in being able to pour out upon the church the riches of the Spirit's grace. Now, those words caught my attention because we tend to think that God is a withholder of his blessings. We pray so much and seem to get so little. Very good vision, of course. And here we find that heaven rejoiced in being able to do it. So some factor was brought to view at that time which gave God the power or the freedom to bring the blessing upon the church. Now, what is the obvious inference in this statement? I'd like to participate in the study period. I'll ask some questions, I'd like to answer back. What's the obvious inference?
They weren't able for
right, but whose fault? Man's fault. The fault of the church or the believers. In other words, if we go back to Elijah's day, for instance, who's was the Spirit poured out back then? Certainly. Why was it not?
Sin.
Right, because of the people, or the lack amongst the people. And we have been in this movement now for 20 years or more, at least some of us have been. And we long to look for the day when the Spirit will be poured out without measure upon God's church in these last days. But it hasn't been. Why not? That's right, we are restrained. Heaven is not able to do it because of our fault, not God's fault. As I read through the Bible and Spirit of prophecy, I find that the picture is going of God being anxious, almost desperately anxious to pour upon the church's blessings. So it's frustrated by our unbelief, by our stubbornness of heart and so forth, and by our lack of understanding of the true science of prayer. So let's spend some time now looking at some of the further conditions of prayer which must be met in order to bring about the desired blessing. And in this custom, this very camping, we'll find a very rich experience waiting us as a people. I find that the experience of Jacob listening at the brook Jabbok for the blessing that God gave to him there is a very important lesson, or contains a very important lesson for us at this time. I've got a patriarchal prophecy which is not the regular paging, so I hope I can find this without too much trouble. And the regular book is about page 197. Thank you very much. Thank you very much. So as you know, Jacob, of course, spent those many years in his uncle's place. And then God gave the command to return to his own land, which he did in obedience to God's command, although to do so meant to face his angry brother and possibly death. Just find the statement now on page 203. Jacob prevailed because he was persevering and determined. His experience testifies to the power of importunate prayer. His experience testifies to the power of importunate prayer. Now, if Jacob learned the power of importunate prayer, and this was the secret of his victory, what must we likewise learn? The power of importunate prayer. And this is what I hope we shall very definitely learn during this camping together this year, the power of importunate prayer. Now, what does this word importunate mean? Well, what do you think? Persevering, right? It means we stay there until we get the answer we're looking for. I always stand in Protestant King at this point to illustrate that from the experience of Elijah. Versus Dwight talks about, this is Protestant Kings this time, of course. And Sister White talks about the effectiveness of Elijah's prayer because he was persevering and determined likewise. Just find the page here. Yes, it's page 156 to 157. It says, it was because Elijah was a man of large faith that God could use him in this grave crisis in the history of Israel. As he prayed, his faith reached out and grasped the promises of heaven, and he persevered in prayer until his petitions were answered. He persevered in prayer until his petitions were answered. He prayed seven times, of course, until the answer finally came. But it was needed 20 times. He would have prayed 20 times until he got the answer regardless. That was importunate prayer also, and brought the same pictures he was given to Elijah back at the brook Jabbok. Now, children, if I make that point, we tend to ask ourselves, why is there this need to pray and pray and pray again and again and again for the same blessing to get it? Why don't we find that once it's sufficient, after all the victory has been gained, Christ offers it as a gift, page 4, not in Desire of Ages. So I just pray once, grasp the victory and we've got it, and go forth rejoicing in the blessing which we have. The obviously, of course, the reason why this doesn't work quite as simply as that. Fortunately, I suppose. Now, going back to the definition of importunate prayer, children know the power of importunate prayer. Don't they? They certainly do. They come to their parents with a request, say, Dad or Mum, give me so and so or such and such, and Mum and Dad say no. They have better wisdom than they give the child this, or maybe it's inconvenient or whatever. Does the child rest content with one effort to get the gift? No. They then begin to pester and to annoy and to irritate and to plead with them until finally the parent, in sheer desperation, breaks down, changes his or her mind, and gives the child what that child wants. Right? So the child has learned the power of importunate prayer and all too often gains success by that method. Now, what is wrong with. Now, what you learn in childhood is what you tend to repeat in your later years. What you do to your parents, what you tend to do to God.
Try to change it.
Right. Isn't that true? What you do in childhood, you repeat in your later years? Absolutely. So that we then ask ourselves, what then is wrong with the child's approach to his parents? And the answer very simply is this, that the child is devoted to changing the parent, not changing itself. Correct? How much thought does a child give to changing itself?
My way.
Excuse me. I'm going the wrong way, I'm sorry. Good. So that if you think back in your own past prayer experience, we tend likewise to concentrate our minds upon changing him. Right. Not ourselves. We tend to think that there's no need there, but that the need is with God. We have to learn, of course, that with God there is no changeability whatsoever. Fortunately, if God should change to suit our whims and fancies, what a sad situation we'd have. But fortunately, God is not changeable. He is unchangeable, the same yesterday, today, and forever, which is a very fortunate thing as a moment ago. So therefore, the power of importunate prayer is designed to effect changes in the petitioner, not changes in God. And when we learn that point and make a point of it, we'll find that we'll advance much more rapidly than our prayer experience. In other words, prayers are to be person-changing prayers, not God-changing prayers. Now, let's begin to look at the scope of this. I'll turn now to the experience of Elijah once again on Mount Carmel. And begin to compare the faith he had, which produced the victory on the mountain, with the much higher level of faith needed to bring about the outpouring of the rain on them at that point of time.
Excuse me, Fred.
Yeah.
Would you like to say something? The last comment you made.
Yeah.
On our prayer, is it also true? It's because we seem to think that God is like us, and we don't understand that He's willing and ready to give us all good gifts. That when we ask for something, like we will withhold that gift even if it's good. Like you said, because it's not the right time or we're inconvenient.
Yeah. Well, of course, one of the big mistakes has always been for men to think of God as being a man. It's always been a great mistake on the part of men. Right, let's come now to the story of Elijah and note the effect of his prayer upon himself. While I'm looking for this statement, I'd like to make the point here. It's on page 1035, volume 2 of the Bible Commentary, originally from the Review and Herald, May 26, 1891. Now, the statement says, a servant watched while Elijah prayed. Six times he returned to the watch saying, there was nothing, no cloud, no sign of rain. But the prophet did not give up in discouragement. He kept reviewing his life to see where he had failed to honor God. He confessed his sins and thus appeared to afflict his soul before God, while watching for a token that his prayer was answered. As he searched his heart, he seemed to be less and less both in his own estimation and in the sight of God. It seemed to him that he was nothing and that God was everything. And when he reached the point of announcing himself, while he clung to the service as his only strength and righteousness, the answer came. So he returned and said, there is the little cloud in the sky. Now, in the book Prophets and Kings, situated on page 1, 5, 6, and 7, it was because Elijah was a man of large faith that God could use him in his grave crisis in the history of Israel. So, let's think about the victory gained upon Mount Carmel first of all. Did that require faith on the part of the man of God?
Yes.
Absolutely. Mighty faith. Think of him standing there alone against Ahab, the king of Israel, the priests of Baal, the people, the army, alone, not one person with him. Every discouraging circumstance living up before him, it took large faith for that man to gain the victory on the mountain that day. Now, when I measure my faith in comparison to Elijah's faith on that mountaintop that day, my faith doesn't look very much at all. What about yours? We're long going to reach that level, I'm sure. So that it did require large faith on Elijah's part to that day gain the victory over Ahab, over the army, over the priests of Baal, and over the people. He had to sustain that faith through long, long hours of watching and contention with the priest of Baal from morning till late in the afternoon. And wouldn't you think it'd be a simple matter for a man of that kind of faith to go and pray for the rain? Wouldn't you? But we find that he went to pray for the rain, and in so doing, there was a great work of changing done in him. There's the words again in the Bible commentary one by one. First of all, it says he kept reviewing his life to see where he had failed to honor God. He confessed his sin and thus continued to afflict his soul before God while watching for a token that his prayer was answered. So how much thought was Elijah giving to changing God? None at all. But how much thought was he giving to changing himself? Every thought. His whole concentration was upon that matter of changing himself so he could become fitted to receive the outpouring of God's blessing at this point of time in the rain which they so badly needed. Now, as we move on, we find that as he searched his own, he seemed to be less and less both in his own estimation and in the sight of God. And when he reached the point of renouncing himself, clinging to Christ, then came the answer. So Elijah persisted until the change in him made him fit to receive the outpouring of the blessing that was needed there so badly. Now, if there was someone in his experience, what about now? Do we need the same change in ourselves? Right? We certainly do. And I believe there's a very important lesson for us to learn in regard to the power of importunate prayer. It's designed to change us, not to change God. Now, when we come before God in prayer, we tend to rush into his presence and lay before him our petitions. We ask for them, and when the answer doesn't come, we sit back and say, well, I guess God doesn't want to give it to me, or I have to wait a little bit, and we just stop praying about that particular point. But Elijah's conclusion was that when he found the answer did not come, he said, well, there must be something wrong with me, some blockage, some hold-up, some impediment, some reason why there is in me something which prevents this blessing from coming upon myself at this time and people too. So likewise, when we find that we ask what God has promised and don't get that blessing, what must we do? What must we conclude, rather?
Something wrong with us.
Right, something is wrong with us. We are the blockage. We are the holder. We are the impediment. We are the reason why God is not able to give to us the blessing which he so much desires to give to us. And then when we take this attitude and go to work searching our hearts, then we shall find the blessing will come. And we must not give up no matter what the circumstances may be. Let's come back to Patriarchs, Prophets and Kings, page 157. It says, he persevered in prayer until his petitions were answered. Next paragraph. Faith such as this is needed in the world today. Faith which will lay hold of the promise of God and refuse to let go until heaven hears. So the same kind of faith is needed now, that which will lay hold upon God's promise and hold and refuse to let go until heaven hears, then comes the victory in due time. Now this means, I like to look at the word capacity at this point. This means that there are levels of capacity which bring to us levels of response from God in due turn. Turn to Matthew chapter 9, verse 29. I'd like to leave this verse and print on your memories during this camping and thereafter. Matthew 9, 29, where Christ healed some sick people. I made a very profound statement in this respect. Matthew 9. Verse 29. It was the healing of the blind men that came to Jesus Christ. Then he touched their eyes, saying, according to your faith, let it be to you. Or in the old translation, according to your faith, let it be unto you. So the word, according to your faith, let it be to you, was the word of Christ to those men. In other words, it was to be according to their capacity of faith. Would the blessing be that came to them? They had a small level of faith, like a small blessings, a large level of faith, they had larger blessings. So when we come before God and receive answers to our prayers, then the answer can be according to what?
Faith.
According to our faith. And faith takes building, doesn't it? It takes work to build a strong faith. It takes effort, it takes study, it takes prayer. It takes believing, it takes exercise to develop a strong faith in God. You might then ask me the question, how was it these men back in Christ were healed so instantly when Christ came to them and said, according to your faith be it unto you? They didn't seem to have time to build up a higher level of faith, did they? How come their faith seemed to be built so quickly?
By the creative power of God.
In what way did they build their faith?
Through Christ.
Pardon?
Through Christ.
Yes, certainly through Christ.
The actual physical power of God.
Well, let's come back to Romans 10, verse 17. Faith comes by hearing, hearing by the
word of God.
So, upon what is our faith built?
The
word of God. What was Jesus Christ? He was the Word of God. Now the more powerfully, or the more you see the power of God in the Word, the stronger your faith will be. Right? So when Jesus Christ was manifest before them in all the glorious power of his righteousness and Godhead, and those people back there came in contact with that power in him, and saw in him the Word of God, the living power of the living God, what was built in them very quickly.
In Romans 12, verse 3, it says, for I say, through the grace given unto me to every man that is among you, not to think of himself more highly than he ought to think, but to think soberly, according as God hath dealt to every man the measure of faith.
Right.
Now, my understanding of that Greek word on measure means basketful.
Mm-hmm.
And if that is in itself is a gift to us.
Sure.
It's implanted.
Right.
Amen.
Definitely. Faith is definitely the gift of God, which comes to us through the Word of God. I greatly appreciate the picture in the first department of the sanctuary. We don't have a blackboard this year, but just picture, if you will, the first department. And as you go in, on the left-hand side is the candlesticks. On the right-hand side is the table of showbread. And of course, in the background, in the middle, is the altar of incense. Now, what do the seven branch candlesticks represent? The oil is what? The Holy Spirit. And the light from that is what? The Word of God. Right. Now, the candlesticks shine across the room upon the showbread on the other side, which again symbolise the Word of God, which we feed upon and eat and are nourished by it. So the lovely picture then of God being a teacher of his people through the Holy Spirit. As the light shines upon the bread, we are then able to see it, to appropriate it, to eat it, and to be satisfied by it. Now, I like to trace through a story in the Desire of Ages, beginning on page 260-261. 262 and 3 rather, and this is to demonstrate the fact that faith was built up in the leper stage by stage as he saw his need and came to Christ for healing. The thing was not quite so instant as you might imagine. It did take time for him to be to have sufficient faith to receive the blessing of Christ. And I would suppose that many of those miracles back there, which seemed to be so instant, were actually the end result of a long process of faith building in those folk as they listened to Christ and saw his mighty works. Now, in page 262, it begins by talking about the cursed thing called leprosy, the symbol of sin. About this one man amongst the others who was shut away because he was a leper, page 263. And this man heard of Christ and hope and faith began to spring up. That's the word, says, well, faith began to spring up. Is that a picture of a sudden blossoming of faith or a seed growing into a living experience of faith? Faith began to spring up. What's the picture you get from those words?
Beginning,
right. A seed sprouting and beginning to grow into a healthy plant. So it was a starting point, and I suppose that some weeks or even months went by before this man finally made it to Christ and got his healing experience. Yet the man knew not how to reach Jesus. The barred as he was from contact with his fellow men, how could he present himself to the healer? And he questioned if Christ would heal him. Is there strong faith yet? No, not yet. But it's growing, isn't it? Right? You're swinging back and forth a little bit. There's belief and there's doubt. And so he recalled having been shut out by the priests and rabbis and so forth. But then he noticed that not one who had sought his help had been turned away. Not one who had sought his help had been turned away. Faith grows stronger at this point, right? The wretched man determined to find the Saviour. Though shut out the city, it might be that he could cross his path in some bar along the mountain roads and so forth. So faith now is growing stronger and stronger as he moves closer to Jesus Christ. Now, as he finally makes his approach, he stands up away and listens and watches. He hears Christ's teachings and he sees the lame, the blind, the paralytic, and those dying of birth, mother, their rights and health, praising God for their strength. Faith strengthens in his heart. Right? So here's the picture of faith began to spring up. Hope strengthens, and now faith strengthens in his heart. He draws nearer, and yet nearer to the gathered throng. So as faith strengthens, he draws nearer and nearer to Jesus Christ, step by step. And finally, he presses through to the Saviour and casts into his feet and says, Lord, if thou wilt, thou canst make me clean. It was Christ's response, I will be thou made clean. And he lays his hand upon the leper. And instantly, the man is totally and completely healed of his disease and goes to be a free man. So does this story then picture an instant leap of faith or a growth from a seed to a mature plant? A growth, right? Now I think we'd find, if we could read the case histories of everyone in Christ here, we'd find pretty much the same story, wouldn't we? Pretty much the same story. Now, what must be recognised, of course, is this, that when there is in us the abiding, living, powerful faith of God in Jesus Christ, and folk come in contact with us that we've been allowed Christ, period, what will they detect or discern? The power of the living Word of God in the human instrument. As they see the Word of God in the instrument, what will happen to them? Faith will begin to spring up. Faith will strengthen. Faith will mature. And faith will bring the victory. Right? So there's this growth in capacity from stage to stage and step to step until the final victory is ultimately gained. Turn now to another story in the life of Jesus Christ, this time the Transfiguration, in which story we find that once again the capacity was a very important factor in what took place in that experience. The story starts on page 4 and 9 Desire of Ages, otherwise in Matthew 17 verse 1 to 8, Mark 9 and Luke 9. And as we know, Christ took three of his disciples up to the mountaintop to join with him in prayer for the strength to do the test in behalf of humanity. Christ must himself gain a fresh hold on omnipotent, for only thus can he contemplate the future. So Christ's own faith is strengthened, of course, by contact with the person and power of God. Now, first of all, we ask ourselves the question, why did Christ take only three of the 12 with him up the mountain on that fateful night? Yes.
It's only because they were the ones that were capable of receiving what he had to offer. The rest of them weren't prepared.
Quite right. Precisely right. A matter of capacity, was it not? A matter of capacity. Now, how did the nine feel about it, though?
Miffed.
They felt, what's the word?
Slighted.
Slighted, yes. But when you take away from the person what he thinks is his right. What's the word for that
again?
Rejected, yes. What's the word either? Discriminated against. Discrimination, that's right. Discrimination, they felt they were discriminated against and made to suffer a loss which they deserved not to suffer. And because of that, they murmured and complained and even lost the power which they previously had to heal the sick and cast out devils and cleanse lepers and so on, which we'll come to in just a moment. Now, if we find another believer enjoying a great blessing we are ourselves enjoying, does this mean we are discriminated against? Never. We tend to think that, though. Sometimes, at least, I think we tend to think that. Now, those nine disciples left at the base of the mountain should have said to each other, well, we've been left behind because we're just unable to go up there with Christ. We need more faith, more righteousness, more purity of thought and action, more humility and more love. Let's then spend our time praying together most earnestly, person-changing prayers, that we do have the capacity to go up next time the opportunity comes. But they didn't do that. And so those three went up and nine stayed back at the base of the mountain. And later, of course, in Gethsemane, we find the same distinction being made between the three and the nine, or the three and the eight, and put one had betrayed Christ and died, was about to die. Now, as far as Christ was concerned, we find on page 420 of the Desire of Ages, he must himself gain a fresh hold on omnipotence while he thus can contemplate the future. Now, did Jesus Christ himself need person-changing prayers? No. Are you sure? Let's read the sentence again. He must himself gain a fresh hold on omnipotence, for only thus can he contemplate the future. Okay, so before this prayer was prayed on Mount of Transfiguration, could he contemplate the future successfully? No, it was too much, too heavy a burden for his humanity to bear. So he had to change then from that situation to another where he could look with confidence into the future and behold his future, right? Now, certainly Christ did not need to have a person-changing prayer as far as righteousness is concerned, as far as love and patience and all those things are concerned. But he did need person-changing prayers in respect to his grasp of faith and confidence in God as a man. Now, but also look at Christ's physical needs as well. We'll go back to ministry for a moment to a well-known statement in this regard. As you've already mentioned before, I think in previous years, that Christ was so weary at the end of his day of work that he was in danger of dying. His brothers actually thought he would die, and they urged him to cease his labor, and he went away and prayed all night, and what happened? He came back next day.
Rejuvenated.
Changed. So we can think of physical changes and spiritual changes. Christ certainly needed to be changed from day to day, from a person worn out to a person refreshed to face his labors once again. Likewise, of course, we need the same thing in our ministry as well. So Christ goes up there to pray, and does his prayer last 2 minutes? 5 minutes? Half an hour?
Hours,
right? The statement says, slowly, so the hours pass slowly by. And to a final, of course, came the great breakthrough, and the glory of heaven was opened up before him, and there was Elijah and Moses to talk to him on the top of that mountain. So that Jesus Christ himself needed to pray for hours and hours and hours in order to receive the richness of God's blessing. Now, is it an easy thing to pray for hours and hours and hours? Tried it? Have you tried to pray all night as Christ did? Have you tried it? I've tried, I haven't got very far. Time soon passes and you find that you fall asleep on your knees or something like that. But when Christ carried this tremendous burden for cursed humanity, and realize his own need of God's personal power and strength to enable him to do the work he called him to do, then he certainly prayed for many hours to receive that blessing. What surprises me is this: the person of such purity, such absolute purity and strength of character, of such flawless righteousness and peace and power, should need to spend that length of time to establish a living connection with his Heavenly Father and bring the inflow of blessing into his life to transform him physically, mentally, and spiritually. But it was so, and there it was. Let's read again page 363 in the same book, Desire of Ages, for a moment. On page 363, it says that he supplicated the throne of God till his humanity was charged with a heavenly current that should connect humanity with divinity. He came forth from those scenes, of course, refreshed and able to cope with the duties of the next day. Now, while Christ is up on the mountain top, his other nine disciples are down below, and they're brought face to face with a need to heal a boy taken to throw himself into the fire, I think it was. And of course, the Jewish leaders were exultant that these men could not do what they claimed to do. And they, in their turn, were quite humiliated when they realized they hadn't had the power they manifested in the past. Now, prior to this experience, they had the capacity to cast out unclean spirits and so on. But when they came face to face with this need, what did they find? They now had reduced capacity. That's why they're sad, isn't it? So when we work very diligently and gain a certain capacity to do God's work at his command, and then we find ourselves with less capacity, that's a rather serious direction to take, isn't it? Those were in real spiritual trouble, very deep spiritual trouble. And worse of all, they couldn't understand why they were in the situation which they found themselves. Why were they in this reduced experience of power to heal the sick and cast out devils and so on? And they came to Christ with a question, asking him, why was this so? And the answer, of course, was given to us on page 430. Yeah, page 430, page 431. Christ said, because of your unbelief, for though I say to you, if you have faith to grant mustard seed, you shall say to this mountain, remove hence to yonder place, and shall remove, and nothing will be impossible unto you. Howbeit this kind goeth not out but by prayer and fasting. Now I believe that, we know that the statement says very plainly that this kind goes not out but by prayer and fasting. What kind of prayer? What's that key word? Importunate prayer, right? That's the key word, importunate prayer. And this is the kind of prayer which lays hold upon heaven's promise and will not let go until heaven hears. And what is heaven here? Because the change has taken place in us which enables God to bless us. I'd like to quote the experience of a man I know very well in Australia. This man came to Campmeeting to get into the game to travel. And he listened to the presentations on God being our doctor. At that time, he was afflicted with a very bad shoulder, which was a result of many years of working in the carpentry and building industry. And as he heard the word or the message preached on God is my doctor, he went home, applied the message, got instant results for his difficulty. The shoulder became quite normal again and strong and active once more. But about the same time, he found himself afflicted with Parkinson's disease, that nervous disorder which causes a man to shake all over, and it's a breakdown of the nervous system, and it's a very, very terrible thing. He prayed about that and applied the same principles, but this time he did not get the same results at all. So what did he do? He just stopped praying and gave up on the whole matter. Now, what was the obvious difficulty? Why was one disease cured, not the other? Obviously. Because of got a larger capacity. And he didn't have that larger capacity. So instead of giving up, as that man did at that point of time, and as we all tend to do, what does such a situation call for?
Press in
is right. It calls for importunate prayer. Prayer which will not let go until heaven hears, right? Prayer which looks upon the promise of God as certain statements on God's part that he will fulfill his word. When God says, I'll heal all your diseases, he means exactly that. I will heal all your diseases and nothing less than all of them. But only when we have the faith, of course, to grasp the blessing that God has for us. Now, in like manner, we learned 2 or 3 years ago to pray for the latter rain. We all prayed for it. How long did we pray for it? Are we still praying for it? Yes. Every single day? I hope so. Because if we don't learn the prayer of importunate prayer, should we receive the latter rain? That's absolutely impossible. So I do believe this principle that an importunate prayer, rightly understood in practice, is extremely important for the bringing of the latter rain. It means that we forget all about change in God. In fact, we guard against any type of prayer or expression which would call for a change in God, and instead look in ourselves to find where in us the change must be made. As Elijah did, as Christ himself did, as the great men of God in the past have done. And then we shall find that we shall get answers where we have not been getting them, and shall make much greater progress in our spiritual experience and bring the latter rain much more quickly. My time has gone to the study period. Any questions or thoughts you'd like to ask or add to this presentation? Yes.
In my own experience, I have a real problem when I focus too much on what is wrong with me. My experience needs to go downhill. When I focus on Christ and what his greatness is, then, you know, maintaining that balance between what is in me and needs to be cleansed, and keeping my focus on Christ, I have difficulty there. You know, looking at me and seeing what is in me and confessing it. But there's still a problem in focusing on me, because it takes my eyes away from Jesus. That's what's keeping that balance. That's what I'm fighting on.
Well, keep working, you'll learn, sure. Balance must be maintained, of course. We shouldn't dwell upon our mistakes over and over and over and over again. See them, confess them, and forget them. Otherwise, they will drag you down. Guess what?
Yeah, you mentioned that when we pray, then there needs to be changes. We need to change from what chose us, what needs to be changed in us.
Right.
Now, when Christ prayed ours, what needed to be changed in his life?
Was in the study period, not his righteousness. He was righteous through and through.
Right.
But he needed his faith to be strengthened. For instance, as I read to you in the Desire of Ages, he could not contemplate the future excepting his faith was strengthened. So there's physical changes as well which need to be made in him. Now, for instance, in the Garden of Gethsemane, we find that he prayed and said, Lord, take this cup away from it, but not my will, but your will be done. And the great change took place when he finally surrendered to his task to have our will be the sacrifice.
So it's not necessarily sin.
It wasn't sin.
It knows us too. It doesn't have to be necessarily sin that needs to be.
Right.
It
could be that the faith is strengthened,
right,
or just be with God,
right,
because we love him so much.
Sure.
Yeah.
Yes.
I would add that it's most likely our humanity that is the problem. I see in Christ, you know, he had to deal with his human nature too.
Sure.
And that's part of the need for his importunate prayer himself, to strengthen his humanity to withstand the assaults that were going to be made upon
him.
Right.
Gina? Yeah, he had a constant struggle with self that was going on, that was draining the other portion. So to replenish one, he would go to God for that replenishing strength. meditated upon Christ's true and holy life, upon his goodness. And as he meditated upon that, thoughts came back on the last 2 years, on their grief and all their mistakes. So there was the other balance coming on. Now they were looking a little bit to themselves and realizing what they had done. But it's a hero. They had been forgiven, and comfort was in that thought. They had been forgiven. And so, these 37 goals of putting away all differences and feeling the need, which as they were weighed with the burden of the salvation of souls, which we should feel that need, they reached higher and higher and faith actually, as fair to say, grew. But the question really comes down to is, you know that some promises are, or seem to be anyways, time related. In other words, when Abraham had his promise, it didn't happen right away. It happened so many years later. On these promises here, it was evident that the promise was due right then. In a very short time. So I guess it's distinguishing maybe when is the promise due now and when is the promise due to be realized at a later date.
Well,
that
was
all
with Abraham, but not his lack of faith. That was a problem because in time, his action showed that he wasn't ready to receive, but he didn't believe it.
I thought he believed it at first.
Well, he didn't, because in time, his action showed that he was.
Well, was that a result of nothing happening in time, or?
But if you really believe the problem, you stay with it as long as you need to. You won't revert to something else. Believe it. And so if you do give up faith, it shows somehow there is something not
quite. I know that in myself, when I have a promise, and I believe it at first, as time goes by, you start to wonder, you know.
Yes, also there's a difference between the actual believing of the promise and the word, but the ability to receive that promise.
Yeah. But in John chapter 4, verse 46 to 53, the apostle Noah's last part of this, in verse 48, it says, Jesus said, unless you need to see Simon, you will by no means believe. Noah said to him, sir, tell me, before my son dies, Jesus said, go away, your son lives. And there's nothing said about his faith. Noah came directly to Jesus to say about his son dying, and then waiting to return back to his home. That same hour when Jesus said to him, your son lives, and he said, believes his whole household. The fact that is, Jesus had said his son lives, he was healed even though he was like a day and a half. It was his son's journey. Yesterday, at the seventh hour, as he was left, which is actually how you know his son was not present, but of Jesus.
Well, that's a very brief portrayal of the Bible, which is more detailed. And when the man first of all came to Christ, he came there with a desire to change Christ. He hoped that the Father's prayers might awaken sense to the great position, he said in the Desire of Ages. And Christ, he hoped, right? And Christ said, except you see signs, you just won't believe. And when Christ said that, his word laid bare the man's heart to himself. He saw where he'd been wrong, where he needed to change, and made the change. Faith grasped the word of Christ and the healing came. There are two approaches, the unbelieving approach followed by the believing approach. The first one fell, the second one brought results. Yes?
There's a slight difference in the wording and the approach to it. You notice the second time he said, sir, come down, ere my child die. In other words, he's saying, if you don't come down, my child will die. You're my only hope.
Right.
And it seems to indicate there that, you know, whereas before he thought, well, maybe he can kill his son. Now he recognizes Christ as the only hope, and he puts his trust in him.
Yeah. Very good. More points or questions? Let's take a break then. Let's see what time it is now. It's 11:15, Joey.